Which did you like better, Jedi or The Empire Strikes Back?
Empire.
Blasphemy.
All Jedi had was a bunch of Muppets.
Ah! Conversation anyway.
Hey Star Wars fans, and welcome to Boring Conversation Anyway. I'm your host Chris, and today we're recording episode 120, I swear, for the first time. As always, I'm with my good friend Thor. Thor, how you doing, buddy?
Less enthusiastic than I was 10 minutes ago when we recorded, when we first tried this. But no, I'm doing good. I'm doing good.
What have you been up to?
I've been playing Star Wars. I guess, whatever. It's fine. Let's talk about something else.
No.
Okay, so yeah, I want people to know that on the Nintendo Switch, you can get all the Star Wars games. They're on sale right now, and I bought Republic Commando, and it's a lot of fun.
Is that, and that's just a one-player game, right?
I think so. Okay. I've only played it for like a little bit. I bought it right before I came over.
Did you buy the racer game on there?
Yeah.
Now, isn't it on the Switch? Is that on sale as well this week?
I think all of them were.
Because we have the racer for Star Wars, but I think on the Switch, you could play other people, right?
I talk about like online.
Like, yeah, I think so, right?
I don't know the answer.
All right,
to that.
We're gonna have to figure that out.
Cool. Yeah,
we have a lot going on today with Star Wars video games because you brought your Oculus.
Yeah, I brought the Oculus, so I wanted to show you the Galaxy's Edge game, which the expansion I think came out. I think maybe yesterday.
Okay,
if I remember correctly, I haven't gotten the expansion. I probably will, but I figured I'd bring it over just to show you the initial game.
Did you bring Vader Immortal too, or you just brought that?
No, they're all on the system.
Because I would
yeah.
love to compare our version compared to the, you know, PSVR, or was it PlayStation VR,
yeah.
right? So I know it's a little cumbersome more than yours is supposedly better controls.
Is that right?
Yeah, that's what I've heard.
Okay.
And it's annoying. I've seen Connor and I've played where you're trying to just do something with your hand and it's like you're doing the same movement just to try to get it to work. And I feel like they should figure out something better. But that's a game that was made for the Oculus and poured it to the PlayStation.
Oh.
So it's not gonna, yeah.
I see.
Right.
Yeah, it's pretty good. I only own the first one. I think there's like three chapters.
Okay. But, all right, great.
Yeah, so the video games are fun.
So what are we talking about today?
We're talking about Dark Empire.
That's right.
The 30th anniversary of Dark Empire, the six-part comic book series that came out in 1991.
One of the first publications from Dark Horse Comics.
I think it was the first.
Okay.
I'm pretty sure. And also, like, at the start, really, of, like, or early on, the influx of what we now call Legends stories.
Well,
in a way, let me put it this way.
Yeah.
Prior to Dark Horse releasing these comics, I don't think comics were taken too seriously when it came to canon. And then when it comes to books, which, you know, after Jedi in 82, right?
82. Right.
Yeah. Not a ton. So you've got, like, you've got the droid show, you've got the Ewok show, you've got the two Ewoks films, I believe, both came out in the 80s.
Right.
And then for books, you know, you've got various sort of books. You've got, you know, Splinter of the Mind's Eye was in 78, obviously. 79, 80, 81, those are the Han Solo trilogy, like the older Han Solo trilogy, not the A.C. Crispin one. You've got novelizations and that sort of thing. But it's not until 91 with Heir of the Empire that's, like, really kind of the start of things.
And the craziness is that we're talking in the same year, Heir of the Empire is the first, the big book, right?
Yeah.
That starts it all off.
Yeah.
And they play right into it. I mean, they talk about Thrawn in this comic book.
They connect to it. They
Exactly. Yeah. It's all part of it.
It's its own thing. And this is after the first book, you know, Heir of the Empire.
Right. We're really starting to see them form the universe, the canon universe here, right? Which will be later strike down by Disney. But you get a big sense of that. Let's talk about the creators on this book here, right? So, Tom, am I going to butcher this here? Vietich?
Sure.
Written by, and then the artist was Cam Kennedy. Now, from what I learned, these guys were pitching this story to Marvel when Disney was still, when Star Wars was still at Marvel.
So, I don't know 100% actually. I thought But I do think you're correct. I read that Lucasfilm had approached this creative team to do a book. I don't know if they had an idea for it or not. And that they took the idea to Marvel. And there's issues with Marvel for some reason.
And Marvel passed on it. Yeah,
I do not know why or what the issues could have been or anything. You know, I don't really know the extent of Star Wars books, comic books, in the 80s. I know that there was droids, comic book tie-ins. But I don't really know a ton of it. I don't know.
It's, you know, it'd be a nice deep dive into the history of Marvel and then, you know, what was the decision to let it go and to let Dark Horse take over?
I mean, let's be honest, like, Marvel's known for making some pretty poor decisions, especially in the 90s.
I mean, that's when the comic book really was the boom happening in the 90s, right?
They're 80s and into the 90s. Sure, like, 80s was a big boom that was, like, I mean, amongst other things.
Because the point I'm just going to make here is that I would say if I was to give you a 10-year span,
right,
85 to 90 and then 90 to 95, I'm going to assure that 90 to 95, Dark Horse Comics sold way more Star Wars comic books than Marvel did in 85 to 90.
Sure.
Right? You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Right. So you're right. Again, mistake that they probably look back on and said they should have kept going, which they have now anyway, so it doesn't make a difference.
You had that, like, that run, I guess, of Star Wars books for Marvel, and I don't know exactly how long that went on for, but there are certainly a ton of them. I think they might have been going on for about 86, maybe they stopped, give or take.
Okay.
86, that Star Wars run, I think, over 100 issues, and those are the ones that are like, I mean, not to like knock any of the artists or anything, but I always feel like they had like a loose sort of idea of what Star Wars kind of looked like and was. It didn't, right. I don't know. It just, you know, everything that came out with Star Wars, especially after the first film and in between the films, but then certainly even in the years after, I think there's always a sense that nobody quite knew what Star Wars was. Even when the trilogy was complete, then only did they get a sort of idea of like what it is. So right, we see okay. that a lot with, I mean, the holiday special, right? Like, that's a good example of like, yeah, we don't really know what this is or what we can do with it.
Right.
And weird sort of things happen. But yeah, it's just kind of crazy to think back, like, that this was so early on in really what would become, like, legends.
Right.
Because, like, Splinter of the Mind's Eye and even that solo trilogy, like, those are legends, but I never really considered...
You're calling it legends now because that's the title of what it is.
I'm calling it just to avoid confusion, yeah.
Yeah, what we're talking about was the...
I mean, this was Star Wars to us. This was...
Right.
Until George said otherwise, this was fact. And we talk a lot about how comic books sometimes...
The extended universe.
Extended universe,
that's you want to call it. That's what it was used back at the time.
Expanded universe, was it?
Expanded universe, yeah.
But we talk about how comic books kind of like a low form of canon. Like, things kind of happen in there.
Oh, definitely. I think so, yeah.
But I think this book, is probably one of, like... This is really held up as canon. I mean, so much so that I had never read it. This is my first time reading it. And a lot of the events that happened to it, I was already aware of because just for whatever reason, they filtered in... through either reading about it in other books, reference to it, or just talking to other fans and things. Like, these are things that most Star Wars fans know, even if they haven't read the exact story.
And also, let's be fair, this is a great segue. Mm. I think before we get into the details, one of the biggest things that I took away from this is that, man, a lot of stuff is reused.
There's a lot of, and we'll talk about it, but there is definitely a lot of like, oh, that reminds me of something I saw in
the sequel trilogy. Yeah.
And we'll get into it.
Exactly.
Some of it seems more blatant than others, so from there on out, I mean, anybody who hasn't read it, and if you wanted to read it and you don't want to know anything about it, then I would probably go ahead and stop listening. But I mean, one, it's been 30 years, and two, like I said, the events in this book are just kind of just general knowledge, I think, at this point.
I think so.
But essentially, I don't know if were you prepared to give like a quick recap on the book itself, or do you want me to?
I think between the two of us, both of us could do it.
Yeah, but it's just kind of shoot from the hip. But it takes place 5 years,
6 years,
6 years.
Yeah, because Heir to the Empire is 5 years. This is right on the heels of Heir to the Empire. Which, correct me if I'm wrong, but Dark Force Rising is not out yet. So these guys are only tying it into Thrawn from the first book. They're not even giving you the rest of the story. So I'm not 100% sure on this, but if you told me that the trilogy comes out, right? It's Heir to the Empire, Dark Force Rising, and then Last Command, right?
Yeah.
What if Last Command is set 2 years after the first fight? Like, you know what I mean? The comic book could be ready wrong. That's why you can't go crazy about it. You know what I'm saying? Because they're a year after Heir to the Empire. 6 years after Return of the Jedi is what they say for this book, right? So I find it interesting because that happens, right? Okay, we didn't know where you were going to be. You know, the book was a huge deal. So if Timothy Zahn has them going in a certain direction, they're not going to change that because the comic book said this happens 1 year after Heir to the Empire. You know what I mean?
I mean, I would assume that there's somebody at Lucasfilm to keep hold of the
I believe
the
so canon. Too. But
also, this book doesn't do anything. Like, it honestly, like, in a way, we end kind of where we began.
Right. And also, too, just not to jump in, me telling you about it being 6 years is not from any information in the comic book. That has already been sourced about how Star Wars fans want to put it in the timeline. You know what I'm saying? Because I don't see it in the crawl that it's 6 years after Return of the Jedi.
Right. So, to give a quick recap, I'm going to go ahead and just straight up read
the crawl.
The crawl for the first book.
Why not?
To give you guys a setup as to where the story begins. So, following the deaths of Darth Vader and the Emperor and the destruction of the second Death Star. Oh man, there's a typo in the crawl. Also, like, I don't think this crawl, I could be wrong, I don't think this crawl was in the original. If you bought the original comic book, I don't think this was there.
It's not. That is the
because
big, yes.
This is a garbage, this, I'm going off track. This is a garbage crawl because the letters aren't slanted. They're just like, they're all flat, but like, spaced like a triangle. Right. Anyways,
it's not only just that. Hang on. The context of it changed, and I deleted it, but I had the original crawl that was in there.
Okay, yeah, I'd love to see, because these books, anybody's listening, you can find them on, we read them on the Marvel app, even though they're Dark Horse books, and they've got the Legends thing printed, so there's differences. But anyways, following the deaths of Darth Vader and the Emperor, and the destruction the second Death Star, or of the second Death Star, the Rebel Alliance proclaimed a new republic over three-fourths of the galaxy. But without the thousands of Jedi Knights who formed the backbone of the old Republic, the new Confederation was a precarious one. Long years of struggle ensued, during which the Imperials regained strength, pushing back the Alliance until the majority of worlds, including the vital Imperial system, fell once again under Imperial control. Then, without warning, civil war erupted, as factions within the Imperial Navy battled for the Emperor's ruling circle for control of the Empire. The rebels seized the opportunity to sow confusion among the feuding Imperials, using captured Star Destroyers to conduct hit-and-run sorties? I don't know.
Military term.
I'm not in the military. Into the war zones. One such raid over the raging Imperial city battleground ended in disaster. The Alliance Star Destroyer Liberator, commanded by Luke Skywalker and Lando Calrissian, crashed on the planet's surface. Only Luke's skillful use of the ship's deflector shields and anti-gravity braking system prevented all aboard from being killed. As our story opens, Princess Leia Organa and her husband Han Solo, together with the Wookiee Chewbacca and protocol droid C-3PO, are on a daring mission to rescue their fallen comrades.
There you go.
And that's where we start.
And I'm giggling because I just realized that I talked to you before about the audiobook.
Yeah.
I could just had the guy read it for us.
I mean, I've got a nice voice. I have a radio voice.
There it is.
So we open up on that. And just to give, because we're going to get into detail and stuff, but that's where the story goes. And as you progress, I mean, the main points of what we see in these six issues is Luke seems to be, like, flirting with the dark side even more than he kind of appears to be in Jedi. He joins the Emperor.
You're right.
The Emperor's back. He's a clone. He's been cloning himself. And Leia has to sort of help bring Luke back and ultimately defeat the Empire. This is also the book, I believe, where we first know that Boba Fett returns. That he makes, you know, the
hanging out with Dengar.
Yeah, weird. But anyways, he makes reference to, you know, the Sarlacc pit couldn't digest me. I think this is where that idea comes from. Even though, you know, you read like Tales from Mos Eisley Cantina, or Tales from Jabba's Palace rather, and they go into that story further. I think this is the origin. I could be mistaken.
Is it the earliest time, 91?
I think so.
Probably.
Yeah, right? I mean, it's before those books. Okay. Unless it was somewhere else, like on the back of a trading card or some crazy thing that you would never know.
Right.
But anyways, that's the gist of the story. Then obviously Leia's pregnant with
the third child,
which is going to be Anakin. And, yeah, I mean, we'll get into the details, but that's the gist of it. Obviously, Leia saves Luke. I think the coolest thing about the story, and I'd only read it once, but you get the sense of, like, is Luke really gone to the dark side, or is he pretending? Because he's telling Leia, you don't know what you're doing, I know what I'm doing, I'm playing the Emperor for a fool. And right. meanwhile, the Emperor's like, I know exactly what Luke's doing.
Right.
And, like, I'm playing him. Right. And, you know, I really want you, and I want your unborn baby, and you should join me. So you just, I don't know, you never really understood if Luke actually had kind of gone to the dark side, or if he was always in control. And I think that's great.
Okay.
I think it's cool to kind of do it that way. I mean, certainly Han was convinced. You know, Han gets into it big time.
Han is pissed at Luke.
But just cool stuff. I mean, that first book, you know, that obviously Han and Leia, they're going to go down and try to save Lando.
So the first book takes place on the Imperial planet. We don't get a name.
Right. There's a couple names that we know of that could be used. Certainly,
Coruscant
could be used. And the other one was, come on.
Abaddon. Remember?
It was something weird. Abaddon.
Yeah. Something like that. That's from the exclusive look of Inside Return of the Jedi from us. Because they were debating on that Imperial planet forever. Remember, that was going to be like, they couldn't figure out they wanted to take on the planet in Return of the Jedi. And George was kept figuring out, was like, well, how do you attack a planet? That's what he kept saying. Like, how big is the force need to be if you attack a planet? Someone could get off the planet at some point. Planet is a real big place, unless you have all the ships surrounding the whole planet.
It's weird for a guy who invented the Death Star to be like, how do you attack a planet?
It's just probably because he didn't like the idea. That's what it was.
So, they land and they're killing droids.
But you know where the droids are from.
Yeah.
The scavengers. Remember, during this whole time... So, what's going on right now? During this war... After the end of Return of the Jedi, the Republic proclaimed a new Republic over 3/4 of the galaxy.
Right.
However, the Empire still existed.
Right.
And it was splintering. It became a civil war. So the Empire was fighting itself and having to deal with the rebels, or at that point, the New Republic, right? So during this battle, it's on the Imperial city planet.
Mm-hmm.
There are Imperials fighting each other. And there are scavengers running around trying to take advantage of it. And the scavengers are the ones who brought the droid army.
There's a lot going on.
Yes. We got cybernetic dogs. We got to talk about that, huh?
There's a lot of things that were invented by this book. And it's just interesting that, I don't know. I think it's just interesting to see a comic book that's kind of telling the future, right? Like telling things that are happening after the films. And they're going ahead and inventing all these things. It's cool way to do it. It seems bold to do it.
Yes. But, yeah. How about seeing the Ewoks helping fight the rebellion?
Yeah, that part, that was weird. It's not something that's really talked about, but he's like, is that the Ewoks?
They're in the background, yeah.
There's no way they're not slaves. they're not little slaves to the rebellion.
You waited until I took a drink before you said that, didn't you?
So this first time we see Luke, he comes out and he looks, I don't want to say evil, but he definitely looks interesting. You know,
I had this figure, by
the way. He's kind of hunched over and he's got the big black cloak and all black clothes. I never had it now. But he stands down an AT-AT.
Right, right.
Which, when we talk about comparisons to the films, I mean, we see Luke essentially stand down multiple AT-ATs in The Last Jedi. And also, you know, it's done differently because it's multiple AT-ATs and he's not really fighting them because he's projecting himself.
Right, whereas, he's not really there.
And this one, he is fighting them. I mean, he brings it down with the Force.
Yes.
It's just one of those things where I was like, I don't consider that, like, they've stolen. No. It's just like, it's so easy to think of, like, an iconic moment to look like that. But there's also no way that Rian Johnson didn't read this. Because not only does that happen, but later we'll see Luke use that sort of projection thing. He'll project himself.
Oh, yeah, that's right.
Yeah.
Oh,
God. Yeah. So it's like, it had already been established a long time ago that was doable. But he did it just... Well, we'll get into it, I guess, when we get there.
So this battle is fierce, and the Falcon flies in because they know that Lando and Luke were on a Star Destroyer.
Right.
Was it the Devastator? I can't remember.
I had it here, but yeah, I don't.
Listen, if they came here for facts, they know they're in the wrong place. So this Star Destroyer, they stole Star Destroyer. They're in the battle with it. They lost
Liberator. Content.
Liberator. Hey, it's close.
Yeah, I think the Rebellion changed the names. So they weren't the Devastator, you know?
So that would make sense. Yeah. So they lost contact with them. So Han, Chewie, Leia, and C-3PO go looking for him. Very much like Empire Strikes Back, right? In that mold.
Yeah.
And they're battling debris. They're going in and out of stuff. And it's very hard what they're doing. You can tell it's a dangerous journey. And then when they get there, they find out that they crashed the Devastator. They see where the beacon is. They go find them. Lando, and by the way, in the audiobook, Lando is played by the Billy Dee Williams, which is amazing. You can find the audio, by the way, on YouTube. It's very easy. All three books are there. Dark Empire, Dark Empire 2, and it wasn't called Dark Empire 3. I think it was like Dark Empire End or something like that. I can't remember.
Yeah.
But he's great in it. And Luke's not there. And he tells him Luke's been gone for like 7 days. He went further into the Imperial City because he felt something, him and R2, right? So Luke is finding himself dark, how dark it is.
Yeah.
And that he's in a dark place and he needs to know more. And he keeps asking the question, why did my father fall to the dark side? What did the dark side offer him that made him fall? Like, he needed to know why he was in the same position as his old man in front of the Emperor. And he said no. Why did my father say yes?
Right.
And that's driving him to figure this out, right? So they play with this and the fact that this battle's going on, and then before Luke brings down the AT-AT, he shows up, and it's a shadowy figure, and it's drawn like the helmet of Vader, right? When you see him come out. And then he comes out to reveal himself as Luke, and then he attacks the AT-AT and everything else.
Yeah. Yeah, it's definitely looks like Vader.
Right?
The hood is on the head and such. And yeah, it's the Imperial Palace that he's exploring, and he's like, you could, you know, get him out of here, whatever, but I'm staying behind because I have to explore this further.
Which drives Han crazy because he thought this mission was stupid to begin with because there's so much other things to do, and now the kid's not leaving. So he's already getting aggravated with that.
Yeah, we've come this way and you're not even, you know. But he stays.
Right. And at the end of book one, because remember, this is 6 books to make the whole story. There is some kind of storm, electrical storm, that sucks up Luke and R2-D2. And that's all we know about it at that point in the book.
Yeah. I mean, it's like abducted by aliens.
Right.
Sort of thing that gets sucked up.
So then when we get to the second book, so the first book, I forgot to mention, the books have titles, each one.
Mm-hmm.
Book one is Destiny of a Jedi. And now book two is The Devastator of Worlds. All right? And we find out that the Empire has these world devastators that essentially create energy out of debris. Is that what I get from that? That's what I hear them talking about? Like they suck in stuff and it creates energy from that?
I think so. They definitely suck things in.
Bottom line though, boys and girls, this reminds me, if you're reading the comic book, so much so of the Operation Cinder from Battlefront 2. Those satellites that were destroying planets with the energy.
Right.
Very close. You know, they're not drawn the same at all, but the idea of this energy beam to destroy things is, to me, the same thing, right?
I mean, essentially, you just said this idea of using a laser. Like, that's not, you can't steal the idea of using a laser. It's like stealing the idea of using pants.
But it's the way it's...
Sorry. It's like these characters are wearing pants, just like they wear. But no, there's definitely similarities.
They're floating in space. They're setting them up to be coordinates. They're shooting them where they want. It's the same thing as these satellites. It's the same thing. It's the guy who came up with this Operation Cinder read this book. Don't tell me he did it. You know what I'm saying? It lays in there thick.
Yeah, I mean, yeah. I suppose so. Oh. I mean, that's always, like, that's the Star Wars thing, right? It's like, there's a new weapon. There's this new weapon it's been Star Wars forever. That's the whole first movie.
Yeah.
The new weapon. And that's what they're kind of talking about, these Devastators.
All right, cool. What else happens in book two?
I have no idea.
Oh, that's fantastic. That's why
I stopped talking.
Lando is leading the Calamari evacuation on the stolen Star Destroyers, right? So that's where Calamari is starting, is the first planet that's seeing these world devastators.
They're being punished for helping the rebellion because, right. you know, they're the planet that built the ships and things for the rebels. So that's where a lot of the action takes place on is on a Calamari.
So, what's his name? Lando's getting them out of there. Now, to go into this real quick, he's on the stolen Star Destroyer, which he doesn't want to do because he's already crashed one, right?
Right.
We find out that Han was offered this gig, but he doesn't take it.
Right.
Which concerns Leia, because it's something that he wouldn't turn down, but is it because he's dad, he's a husband?
So yeah, this isn't the deadbeat dad Han Solo that we'll see in the Disney World. Han deliberately didn't do this so he could try to spend time with Leia, because they have two kids at this point, there's another one on the way, and also just so caught up with the Rebellion and the New
Jason
Republic.
Jason and Janna, right?
Something like that, yeah. Yeah. Twins.
Jason is just, to me, not a Star Wars name, but all right.
But if you put an apostrophe after the S, it's Star Wars name.
There you go.
Yeah, that's all you gotta do. Apostrophes.
That's right.
But yeah, so that was his sort of thing.
Right. I'm not risking this stuff anymore because there's a lot going on.
I don't think it was a matter of him. I could be wrong. I felt it was just like, no, I'm gonna take some time to
what he says it to her is like, we haven't been together.
Right.
It gets into that. We'll get into it for a second, because it gets into that in a comic book. We haven't been together for a long time. We're never alone. Luke can take care of himself. You know, remember, I'm still your husband, basically. He's looking for some fun time, basically.
What?
Yeah, oh yeah. That's
how you read it.
Oh, this is how it was read to me in the audiobook.
Wow. So you're saying he was like, Han Solo was like, listen, I go help out Lando, but I just got to get laid.
Essentially is how it says.
All right, everybody. Luckily, I have it right here. Yeah. So here we go.
Go ahead.
Han's, you know, consoling Leia after the mission. This endless war. It seems like we've only been alone for 5 minutes since Mon Mothma married us. I really wanted to go with Lando, but I accepted this other assignment so we'd have a chance to be together.
Right. Keep going.
Then she says, she says, Han, something awful is happening to Luke. He's still alive, I can feel it, but he's getting farther and farther away. We must help him. We need some time to ourselves, Leia. Luke doesn't want any help. He says he has to do it alone, and I believe him. And then, I guess she kind of shoots some daggers. Besides, you know me, I'm not about to challenge the judgment of a Jedi.
Right.
I mean, how much further after the...
Keep going.
No, that's it. Scene's over.
Okay, so then the audiobook adds stuff.
Yeah. I did not get the impression. I mean, certainly, like, you know, they would probably...
Because, you know, the audiobook is an audio drama. It's not one guy reading everything.
Right.
It's just a totally drama. They brought on... And I recognize Solo's voice that I know he's done Solo before from one of the other projects.
Right. So they were like, you know, this comic's great, but can we just make Han Solo a little more horny?
Because he says, you know, you're with a smuggler... And it's a bunch of giggling and stuff. So they really get into it. Yeah, okay. So that's just the audio part of it.
Yeah, we're talking about a comic book because I don't know what they did, but that's the way to read it is just they just want to be together. They just want to,
which is much,
take a breath.
Yeah,
essentially,
there you go.
Take a breath, and that maybe this is an opportunity that they could have done it. And this is interesting too because Han. I don't feel like Han is just saying this stuff about Luke to like get what he wants, which is, you know, time with Leia and for her to not worry. I think he really believes it. He really trusts Luke. Luke knows what he's doing. We see the evolution of that in the film, certainly, where he starts to trust Luke more and more and get a sense where, you know.
Exactly. Yeah, exactly.
No longer delusions of grandeur, as he would put it.
But now you got Luke, who's being taken to this city, the planet of Biss.
Yeah.
Which is essentially just a dark side planet, right? It's just the dark side is very strong on this planet. And he was traveled in a dungeon ship that was used during the Clone Wars.
Yep.
Which is pretty cool.
Yep.
And then they even put him in a cell that was designed for a Jedi, to hold a Jedi in there. And then I think of, as soon as I read that, you think of season 8 of the Clone Wars, where they're holding Darth Maul in the Mandalorian Jedi cell.
See, I thought about the High Republic. I don't know if you remember the Jedi cell for that, but essentially they trapped the Jedi around like all this suffering that was like,
right.
Yeah, it was a really great idea. That was my first High Republic book.
Yep, right.
That's
right.
What it made me think of. But yeah, the second book is where we meet the Emperor.
Yes.
He's back. Can't keep him down.
Goes into the whole thing about cloning. And now the clones can't hold on to the dark side, so they decay.
Yeah.
And, you know, this is not the first time I died, nor it will be the last. Which I think is directly a quote from The Rise of Skywalker.
Yeah.
That's like it lifted, like 100% quote.
I don't know. But this is definitely implying, like, I've got all these clones. The dark energy runs through the body. It is what it is. Like, it hurts. It sucks. But I go through bodies pretty quickly.
Right.
Whereas, like, it says, it implies, and I think the prequels kind of would change my look at this, but this certainly implies that when you saw me die at this Death Star, that wasn't my first time dying.
Right. Oh, definitely. What it implies is that when we meet him for the first time in 1983, that he's a clone. Because he's been doing this for a long time. He's already been a clone. Yeah.
Technically. Yeah. In Rise of Skywalker, I mean, there's a lot of things confusing about that movie, and like, I mean, literally dialogue in that movie is like, well, somehow he found a way to clone himself. Like, that's how they write off, like, how the Emperor's back. But I don't know if they got into it, if it was essentially this idea that, like, yeah, I burned through these bodies pretty quick, or that, like, you know, 30 years later, he still hasn't quite figured it out. Because he's, like, going through. And we see he's all screwed up. Like, he's not that the Emperor was exactly the embodiment of physical health, but he's, like, decayed and weird when we see him in Rise of Skywalker.
Right.
So I didn't really know that. To me, it just makes sense to do it this way, because if I was going to clone myself, I wouldn't pick my 80-year-old body to clone.
Right.
If it's like, I'm like a physically fit, you know, 30-year-old.
But it's just the dark side is just burning through it, that he ages and decays at a faster rate.
Like, real fast, right. And he's going through these clones. That makes sense. Yeah.
So, you know, again, that's in a comic book. And then by the time 8 years later, when we get to The Phantom Menace, we start to see that's not the story that George is telling in those three movies.
No, and it doesn't necessarily, they don't cancel each other out.
Right.
Because we see what happens to, you know, Chancellor Palpatine, and we see him quickly sort of age and get all screwed up when the lightning and that kind of thing.
Right.
But you could say, like, yeah, maybe he went through two more clone bodies between
them. Or even one more before we get to Return of the Jedi.
How quickly does it take to go through, you know, a year, 2 years?
Because it's not perfect match of how he looked in at the end of, Revenge of the Sith?
And he doesn't look Return exactly Jedi. Like the, you know, like, Return of the
it's
Jedi.
Not the same makeup, it's not the same thing.
So it does look different.
It could give you enough. I'm not saying that's why they did it.
No, that is not why.
It is not why they did it. They just didn't match it. But it's, you could play with that. There's a little bit of a space to play with, say, okay, there. Because there's nothing in the trilogy that says who he is. We don't see him until the last movie, you know?
Yeah, so you got to remember is that this is all before the sequel trilogy.
Right.
Or the prequel trilogy, excuse me.
Right.
Both, actually. But.
And it's, well, the biggest thing to me was that one of the quotes was, after all, I live primarily as energy, formless and powerful.
Yeah.
So he's letting you know that he's used to this already. You know what I mean? So it's very interesting how they did that. But it does scream of The Rise of Skywalker.
Yeah, there's just no way like I said, the Palpatine clone thing, that's just in people's minds. Even if they haven't read the story or not. Which, that's kind of where we get into it, where it's like, you know, Star Wars is sort of like this thing, like you add something to it. And then other creators take what you had and they do their thing with it. And like when I talk about Rian Johnson and whether he did this or not, when he talked, you know, the shot of Luke in front of all the AT-ATs, that's fine. Like that's okay with me to take that. That's cool. Like it's a cool shot. Like, there's nothing about it. And then you changed it a little bit. And we talk about him using the projection. That was done differently in a big way, but that's fine. But it's like, yeah, we're just going to do what the comics did and have a clone of the Emperor. It doesn't sit with me that well. It never did.
Right.
You know, if you were like, we're going to bring the Emperor back, but we're going to do it in some other way. I mean, I wouldn't love that either. But at least you're trying, I guess. I mean, and also, one of my issues too, I always said this, I've said this multiple times, but it's like the idea of, you've got, you know, your heroes, and they defeat your villain, but then there's like, oh, but then he came back to life, and we got our hero who comes in, and now Rey comes in and defeats it. It's like, yeah, we're defeating the Emperor again, but now it's Luke and Leia, which I'm okay with, rather than just some other person.
Right.
You know, like, if you want to say it takes away...
tied into the story.
If you want to say this takes away from the end of Jedi with the Vader, you know, okay, I understand I understand, but it's Luke and Leia who defeat him this time around, and I'm cool with that, too. And it's really a great sort of moment, too. This story is really more about Leia than Luke.
And also, too, you said this, I'm sure you said this off air or on air already, but it's a compact story. It starts, it ends, it doesn't, you know, spoiler alert, they beat him, right? So
they beat him. Luke is a Jedi. Leia is still
right
becoming a Jedi, or she's further along, certainly. But nothing, like I said, nothing impacted it in a way that would affect someone who was telling another story about, like, for example, Timothy Zahn.
Right.
You know, because this, like an episode of a TV show, like a sitcom, like we're right back where we started at the beginning of the episode.
Right, exactly. Yeah. Right. So to me, that's different than...
One thing this kind of reminds me of, this story, to me, has the feel of like a big event. Like, it feels big. It feels like it could be a movie. It feels very dramatic, and it just, it has that feel. So it's not just like a little like one-off or anything. It's well done. I mean...
Oh, no, this story is good. For their jump out of the box, you know, for Dark Horse Comics, it's a home run.
Yeah. But, so it's just sort of interesting, the comparisons. I don't talk about it too much, but Leia's getting the sense from Luke, and he's in trouble. And like I said, you don't really know, is he in trouble? Or is the Emperor playing you to think he's in trouble? Is Luke in control?
Which was pushing her to... get to Luke.
Yeah, all those sort of things. And there's battles going on. I mean, I feel like there's not too much that we really have to get into.
They get to Nal Hutta. Is that the first time we hear about Nal Hutta?
Nal Hutta, yeah, and there's some talk about, like...
This is where Han used to live. They go to his old apartment.
Yeah.
Right? And that's where we get to see Boba, and we get to see Dengar, and...
Yeah, they bring back Boba Fett, and spoiler alert, he doesn't do anything in this either. He doesn't do anything. He just chases Han. He's just there.
This is a story that you and I talk about all the time with Joe. It's the same stuff, man. I told you, the Boba Fett comeback is the greatest comeback ever. Are you kidding? I care about Boba Fett now. And did I ever before? The answer to that was no.
Yeah. Yeah, he doesn't do much. But, they go to Nal Hutta, and they've got a plan, and they're going to go to the Imperial world and save Luke. And
yeah, and they meet some characters that are friends with Han, and one of them is Salla.
Salla.
S-A-L-L-A. And she looks drawn pretty close to Sana? Yeah, Sana. S-A-N-A. Who claimed to be Han's wife in the 2015 run of Star Wars.
Right, yeah, you meet, like, essentially Han's ex-wife.
Right.
Like, what?
Which turns out it was just a lie for a job, but she's sticking with it.
Yeah, so, it's good to, like, trick your audiences, but then just hit the eraser on it afterwards. That's great storytelling. Psych! You thought he was married? Not the so slave, great. But, slave. Yeah, similarities are there.
Yeah. Very close.
Which I don't get. Like, just go ahead and take her from this and put him in the new canon, if you know what I mean?
All right. Just
straight steal the characters.
Why not?
Just rip it off, then.
Another thing quickly was said by Mon Mothma is that it's now clear to me that the future of the New Republic depends on the revival of the Jedi Knights.
Yeah.
That was cool. That's like, we're not doing this alone. We need the help. So that means you're waiting for the new Jedi to begin to help your new world survive, right? So it's not like it's going to happen overnight.
It's not going to happen overnight. And I think something to consider, too, is, you know, Luke's all alone in his pursuit of this. Like, how do you start the new world? You know, he's all alone. And so he's exploring. And event, you know, that's going to lead to him exploring darker things. He's got no guide, right?
Like, right,
there's nobody
right.
to sort of guide him. And I think that's where he's going. But also, it does kind of go back to what I felt is like one of the things you really... talk about when you talk about Luke and Jedi is he didn't fear the dark side at all.
Right.
And that's why he was willing to play with it in a way or flirt with it. And he still doesn't fear the dark side. He never has. At least as from Jedi on, he's
right
in it.
Right, exactly, yeah.
Whereas maybe Vader did, even though he embraced it. Maybe that's kind of the downfall of a lot of Jedis, is fearing the dark side.
Right. So, and here it also too, it brings up Slave 2.
Slave 2. We never see it, though, right?
No, I don't believe so.
Yeah, I don't think we ever see Slave 2.
And what was the purpose of that? That Slave 1 was destroyed?
I don't know. They didn't really get into it.
They didn't get into it, right?
Or like he's like Slave 1 had so many parking tickets by the time I got out of the Sarlacc pit that I was just like
I'm just going through the major beats here. So Leia finally shows up in front of the Emperor. We got to get into that.
Yeah.
With Han. Han is super pissed at Luke. Right? Yeah. He tells him, I'm going to kill you. Yeah, I'm going to kill you.
And Luke grabs him by the throat and lifts him up out of the air.
Yes.
It's like, ooh, this is not the get I've had on Tatooine.
And he's like, so I don't doubt that I'm going to die, but it's going to be not by you. And I was just like, oof.
Yeah. And it's like, yeah, it's like, is he like acting? Or is he serious?
That's the whole thing. Never know. Yeah.
Yeah. Pretty cool. So, in book five, we've got, you know, just the progression.
Yeah, you find out the Emperor is not looking for Luke anymore anyway. He knows what Luke was doing, like we talked about earlier, and that he's a whole time set his sights on Leia, but not just for Leia, because he believes she's powerful too, but for the unborn child. He believes that one is the most powerful one of all of them.
I don't think he's, even though he tells her, he's not really after Leia at all. He's after the baby, because that, you can do whatever you want with that. They're young enough. There's no changing, like, there's no turning Leia to the dark side, like...
Right. Right.
Even beyond, like, Luke. Like, Leia just has such a strong resolve. It's just not going to happen. But if you could get the child. And also, like, you know, the thing you think about is, like, God, where are her other children? And how in danger are they? The Emperor's back, and he's after them. Because he couldn't clone himself a working penis. Essentially. So that sounded like a joke. But if we fast forward a little bit, and we get into the lightsaber battle, the Emperor puts himself in a new body. Luke is trying to destroy the clones before he can do it.
Right.
He doesn't destroy them all. And he puts himself in a new body, and they start to fight. And the Emperor is butt naked.
In the fight, yeah.
In the fight. I mean, we never see his,
parts?
Yeah. We never see his penis. But, but there is a shot, though, where it's like, I mean, if you look at the comic... It's not like they've, like, put it in, like, a shadow or something. It just doesn't look like he has one.
No, yeah, it is weird.
He's like, listen, if you think the dark side destroys a human body, you ought to see what it does to a human penis.
I just think...
I couldn't stomach it anymore.
I think we're good there. I think we're good on that one? Yeah. So what I'm saying is
I don't think we're good. I think I need to talk about the Emperor's penis more.
No, I think you said it enough. And it's drawn in 1991. I don't think they're drawing a wang.
No. But...
So I don't think it's for storytelling purposes. I just think it's because they were just not going to draw
it. No, you're not going to draw, but you put it in like a shadow, like you would on like TV or something. It was like, if you see it, okay, it's a shadow.
I got you.
So it's like a well-lit version of him.
Like Austin Powers and just have him behind something every time they're talking to him.
Yeah, I mean, that works too, right? But also like his skin, again, because it's a comic book and the way it's colored and such... It's this greenish sort of yellow, and that's just the lighting, but there's also, like, these, like, circles that are kind of on his skin, which is, like, is that your skin? Are you wearing a suit that I'm not aware of?
No,
like,
he's starting to... to me, it's always been... Even though it's a fresh body, it's already starting to reject the dark... You know, the dark side starting to go through it already.
And the first thing the dark side does is, like, we're going to cover you in polka dots.
Well, I think those are burn marks.
I don't know. I mean, maybe. They don't really get into it.
I think that could be all me making that up, but I'm just trying to figure out what that is. What is it, old age spots already? It's a new clone. No, why would you have that?
They're like the size of like a half dollar. I don't know, and his feet have no arches. Like he's wearing it. Maybe he's wearing like a skin suit.
Maybe.
You know, something like for the cloning. I mean, they'll get into it, but like, yeah, I don't know.
Well, that would make sense then, because they didn't throw him in the shadow, man. Maybe you're right on that one.
Yeah. We got to call this guy up and
ask
him. Find out. So the cover for the last book... is pretty good. It's got Leia on the cover. I mean, all the covers are really terrific. But it's got her on the cover, and she's got this black cloak, and she's looking pretty mean, and she's holding a flashlight in her hand. That is the worst
lightsaber
hilt I've ever seen drawn. No offense. But that is definitely, he's like, yeah, I gotta paint this cover for the Star Wars book, and he got his wife to just hold a flashlight as a reference. And then the cover shows, I mean, it kind of answers our question. The cover shows an interpretation of Luke fighting the Emperor's clone, where the Emperor
right.
has a red lightsaber and he has a black cloak, and kind of looks almost like Vader-ish, but without a helmet on. So maybe that answers our question a little bit on how naked was the Emperor during the fight. Maybe not at all. I don't know if there's anything else to cover. I mean, they obviously saved the day. The Emperor's defeated. I don't know. Do you?
No, I think that was pretty much it, man.
That's pretty much it. I mean, Luke and Leia kind of do it together. They like focus their minds, I guess. Like they together they're more powerful than separate.
Than
and
separate.
They don't strike him down with the Force or anything. I think they just, what is it? Do they crash a ship? I can't quite remember. Well, they create like a Force storm.
Yes.
And like crash it, attack the ship or something like that. Interesting. Or maybe I really should have figured this out beforehand.
Good.
But anyway, they defeat him. They defeat the Emperor together with their mind powers. The Holocron is in this, and I don't know if that is earlier or not. I don't know the origin of the Holocron, but this has got to be a pretty early
version of the Holocron.
Yeah. And that's something that Leia had, the Emperor had, and he's after it. It's going to teach him. And then, the Jedi Knights will rise again. Last word in the comic book from Luke.
Exactly.
He said, your children, the Holocron, this is the beginning.
So what did you think of what did you think?
Oh, it's terrific. I liked it a lot. I would definitely recommend it to anybody to read.
Yeah, me too.
I mean, does it have... And there really no story issues. I mean, the way it's written, it does a lot of explaining, which is fine. Comic books sometimes do that.
Yeah.
Sometimes comic books let it be explained in the dialogue and the pictures. But they're clear. So there's a lot of words in it. I'm not surprised. It wasn't probably too hard to transfer it over to a novel version. Pretty good. You know, there's something in this that Star Wars writers always do this. Where like they need like an analogy and like, oh, we got to insert like an analogy, but we got to make it Star Wars. And there's a point where they're talking about the two ships like meeting and they're like, they say like by a rancor's kiss. And it's like, what are you talking about? That takes me out of the book more than if you had referenced like it's Abraham Lincoln.
It's like saying the skin of your teeth is by a rancor kiss. Is that
just yeah. That would work.
Yeah.
Like, I know. And just like, it just always opens up ideas of like, does everybody know what a rancor is? What does it mean?
That's crazy.
You're just like inserting Star Wars into it. But I mean, that's a minor gripe, and I have that with every Star Wars author that's ever existed, for the most part. It's very popular to do it.
It's out there all the time.
It's
just
like, oh man,
it feels
like
forced.
Dagobah out here. Yeah. Like, what do you know about Dagobah?
Yes. Yes.
Billions of systems. Like,
I know, man. You're absolutely right. But I think that's it, man.
Yeah, I don't know. Oh, just because we were talking about it, and I don't think we mentioned it, we talked about the Luke projecting his body. He projects his body to make Leia and Han think he's getting on the ship with them and leaving.
Right.
And that's what he uses it for. And then he says, by the way, I'm not on the ship.
Yeah.
And you know, I have to do this.
Because that was awesome, though, wasn't it? Like, you're like, wow, man. That's what I'm like.
Kind of a dick move.
But no, they're just that's why I was like, you can't say that he had to have read this.
No, absolutely.
Right?
Okay. Actually, I could be remembering things wrong, but I feel like at some point after the film, he had made a reference to like, hey, I didn't invent that.
Yeah.
Like, I read the books. I know the stories. And that's why, like, with Rian Johnson, whether you like it or not, I don't fault the things he did because he was not just taking stuff. And, you know, I don't know. The way he did it, it's very different than the way they did it.
Exactly.
But yeah, I don't know. Got nothing else.
That's it. I said we sign out of here, man.
All right.
So listen, guys, check us out on Twitter and Instagram and email us. And please leave us a review for Apple. That helps out a lot. And, you know, we have a YouTube channel where we're just posting the shows. This way you guys can check them out a different way. And if you want to support us in a different way, you can check us out on TeePublic and you go check out our designs and stuff. All right.
And if you have anything to add about the Emperor's penis, just at me on Twitter and I will answer your questions. I'll talk about it with you, whatever you want. We'll figure this whole thing out.
Say goodbye, Thor.
Goodbye, everybody.
All right, guys. Thanks for joining us. Go make some droids.